绝对硬核，深度学术，非常烧脑，特别有趣。NECPA 北美华人电力协会专业报告。
好的，各位在线的观众朋友们，大家好，欢迎来到NACPPA 北美华人电力协会组织的这个 Webinar。我是樊淼，我现在呢是在美国的西门子 PTI 工作，主要从事这个电力系统仿真软件的研发工作。那共同参与本次策划的还有姚瑞博士，姚瑞博士呢目前是在美国的阿贡国家实验室工作。那我们今天呢非常荣幸的请到了三位嘉宾来就这个微电网 microgrid 这个相关的研究工作呢进行交流。首先呢，第一位嘉宾也是我们的主讲嘉宾是徐岩教授，是来自新加坡南洋理工大学电气与电子工程学院。
大家好。
好的，那我再简单介绍一下徐岩教授。徐岩教授现任新加坡南洋理工大学电气与电子工程学院助理教授，新加坡南洋理工大学能源研究所智能电网与微电网分部主任。徐岩教授的研究方向包括电力系统稳定和控制、微电网和智能电网的数据分析。第二位嘉宾呢是陆宁教授。陆宁教授呢是北卡州立大学电气与计算机工程系教授。陆宁教授的研究方向呢包括电力系统复合建模与分析、能源管理系统开发、可再生能源并网、微电网建模与控制等。那具体详细的介绍呢在咱们之前给大家群发的这个邮件还有这个微信的推送当中都有详细的介绍，我在这儿就不多说了。那陆宁教授您好。
您好。
你好，你也跟咱们在线的观众打个招呼。
大家好，我很高兴今天呢有这个机会能够参加这个 seminar。刚才你说了这个 seminar 是大概什么时候开始的？其实在我觉得七八年前的时候，在协会成立之初我们就开始举办这个 seminar， 但是当时因为条件的限制我们就是没有做得这么好，而且我觉得这一届我看了很多的 seminar， 从开始到现在我觉得你们这一届做得非常好，是后浪把我们前浪拍在了沙滩上。
好的，那陆宁教授也是我们 NACPPA 的前任的主席也非常欢迎您的参与。第三位嘉宾呢是顾伟教授。顾伟教授呢现在担任东南大学电气工程学院副院长，分部式发电与主动配电网研究所所长 IET Fellow。顾伟教授的研究方向是分部式发电、微电网、配电网与综合能源系统等。顾伟教授你好。
韩淼，你好，你好，你好，这个大家好，也是十分高兴，就是说有机会能够来跟大家做一个交流吧，也是向大家学习啊。这个徐教授和陆教授，应该来讲都是闻名已久的啊，我也经常就是说在这个期刊上面看到大家的论文，所以说也是十分高兴啊，能够借这个机会给大家交流一下在微电网这个方面的一些研究。
好的，非常感谢顾伟教授。那咱们今天的 webinar 呢主要分为三个部分。第一部分呢是由徐岩教授做大概三十分钟左右的这个seminar， 一个关于微电网的主题报告。之后呢是我们的云上圆桌论坛，大概是20到30分钟，是请我们三位教授根据他们各自的研究成果呢对这个微电网 进行讨论。那这个圆桌论坛呢，主要是由姚瑞博士来主持。那最后大概我们留5到10分钟的时间呢，是回答在线观众的提问。那，如果大家在这个讲座过程当中有什么问题呢，可以在我们的留言区留言。另外呢，如果有谁想直接通过语音的形式与我们的嘉宾进行交流呢，可以点击这个 Zoom 上面有一个 raise hand， 就是举手功能。我们会在适当的时候呢，允许你通过语音的形式直接的与这个我们的嘉宾进行交流。好的，那现在我们就进入第一部分。那我们现在一说起这个微电网呢，我觉得它的主要特点就是，第一是它是这个电网非常小，第二呢就是微电网它一般可以进行这个孤岛运行，也可以进行并网运行。另外呢，在微电网里面一般都有很多的这个 distribution generation， 就是这个分布式电源，比如说光伏发电啊，还有一些储能装置，所以这个它的系统的这个不确定性 uncertainty 呢也是非常大。所以微电网它对于这个维持系统的正常运行，比如说频率还有电压呢，都有非常高的这种控制的要求。那在新加坡呢，南洋理工大学呢正在他们的一个岛叫做 The Marco Island 上面建设一个网络化的一个微电网系统。那今天呢，徐岩教授将会通过介绍这个微电网的这个项目，来介绍一系列的关于微电网控制运行和规划的一些方法。那我们现在就把时间交给徐岩教授。好的，有请徐岩教授。
好的，谢谢谢谢范博士。行，那我现在把我的这个屏幕共享一下。好的，行大家现在应该可以看得到吧？
可以看到。
好，行，大家那个早上好晚上好今天非常这个高兴能有机会和大家交流，然后介绍我们在这个分布资源和微电网方面的一些研究的工作。那么我这个PPT 呢是用英文做的，然后之前也是用英文讲的，所以我就干脆还是用英文讲等一下这个我们讨论的时候，我们就是可以那个用中文都行。好 ，OK， good morning, good evening, friends and colleagues. It is my great pleasure to share our research works on coordination of distributed energy resources in microgrids. This is the general outline of my presentation today. So first of all, I will give you a general introduction to a microgrid demonstration project called REEDS, Renewable Energy Integrator demonstration for Singapore. And then after that, following the timeline of the research problems, I will introduce our specific research works in microgrid control operation and hierarchical control between the operation and the control, as well as the planning of the microgrid. Okay, so first of all, I give you a general introduction to this project. Actually, this project was started back to 5 years ago, since 2015. This project is a microgrid demonstration project, which is for the research and the development to collaborate with the local industry and the government. So the purpose of this project is to build up R&D platform for test bedding and showcase of the DER technologies and microgrid technologies. And then we collaborate with the local industry and the government to promote the methodologies and technologies to the other countries in Southeast Asia region. Okay, so this is a map of Singapore. We are actually an island country, a city country. So you can see from the east to the west is 40 kilometers, and from the north to the south is 30 kilometers. So we do not have large-scale wind farm, solar farm, rather than we have the localized distributed energy resources such as the solar PV, because we are located in the equator of the Earth, so we have a lot of solar resources. So the local government and the industry are very interested to promote microgrid technologies. So in this island, this is our university. And in this island, we are giving around 60,000 square meters to develop this networked microgrid system. And this project was supported, funded by the Economic Development Board, National Environmental Agency, Energy Market Authority, as well as the National Research Foundation of Singapore. This project is an industry-oriented project. So we have over 20 industry collaborators to build up a total of 8 sub-microgrids, and all of the microgrids will be interconnected to form a networked system. Okay, this is the roadmap and the framework of the microgrid system. So we are going to develop a hybrid microgrid system. For generation resources, we have diesel generators, renewable energy resources, including the solar PV, a very small wind turbine, as well as the tidal energy. And we also have the fuel cell supplied by another industry collaborator. And for energy storage system, we will have a mix of electric batteries, including the Li-ion batteries and the redox flow battery, and supercapacitors, flywheels, as well as the power-to-gas energy storage. And for the loads, we have the on-island industrial loads and the residential loads, as well as the controllable load simulator. So in the first phase, we are going to build 4 independent microgrids, each with around 500 kilowatt to 1 megawatt. And in the second phase, we will have another 4 microgrids in a cluster configuration, and each will have a capacity of 100 kilowatt to 250 kilowatt. And all of the 8 microgrids can be interconnected with each other, and the whole networked microgrid system can be operated in the grid connected mode with the main island, as well as the islanded mode. Okay, as mentioned earlier, this is an industry oriented project. So for different parts, we have different collaborators to involve. For example, for the generator side, we have suppliers such as Rolls-Royce and MTU, which is a very famous diesel generator brand. And for the microgrid controller development part, we have been collaborating with Rolls-Royce and EDF Singapore Lab, as well as a startup company in France called Matchum. So all of the 8 sub-microgrids will be hosted and operated by different companies. So they are also developing their own microgrid controllers, so they can demonstrate their products and the technologies. So this is the general information of this microgrid project. Okay, this is the electrical structure of the networked microsystem. As mentioned earlier, we have a total number of 8 sub-microgrids, and all of them are interconnected with the 6.6 kilowatt linkage bus. And in fact, each sub-microgrid, they have a different mix of the DERs depending on the company's requirements and their investment. For example, the number 7 of the microgrid belongs to Rolls-Royce, and the number 4 belongs to the EDF Singapore Lab. So in my group, I'm mainly collaborating with these two companies, Rolls-Royce and EDF Singapore Lab. Okay, and some on-site pictures, the diesel generators, rooftop solar PV, energy storage, and this small wind turbine. I need to highlight this small wind turbine because it is actually the first and the largest wind turbine in Singapore. Because we are located in the equator of the Earth, so we do not have many wind resources. But good thing is that we do not suffer from typhoon. So this wind turbine is actually a low speed wind turbine, which is to just showcase the wind power generation technologies. And this is a gas tank. And we also have some small meeting rooms. And this is a double glass rooftop on the PV. Okay, so this RIS platform provides a very good, comprehensive R&D platform to do industry-oriented collaboration. In my group, my research focus generally focuses on the system-level coordination of the distributed energy resources in the microgrid. My other colleagues are working on the hardware side and the power electronics converter design and control. But in my group, I mainly focus on the system level control operation and planning of the DERs. Okay, for the physical layer, we mainly focus on three types of the DERs. The flexible load, including the demand response, which also consists of price-based demand response and the incentive-based demand response. HVAC, which is known as thermostatically controllable loads, as well as their aggregation in the building level. And second one is energy storage. We mainly consider the electrical batteries, supercapacitors, as well as the thermal energy storage, including the ice tank and the heat tank. And for distributed generators, we mainly focus on the intermittent renewable energy resources based DG, including the solar PV and the small wind turbine, as well as the controllable DG, including the micro turbine and the CCHP unit, combined cooling heating power unit. And for the specific research problems, we cover the whole spectrum of the microgrid from primary and secondary control in milliseconds and the seconds level to the operational dispatch in minutes to hours time scale, and to the microgrid planning, which is to optimally size and site the DR resources. This is in the years and two decades time window. And for the research methodologies, for the controller design level, we mainly focus on the decentralized control and the distributed control. Because for this network, the microgrid system, the different sub-microgrids belong to different entities. So it may not have a full centralized controller. And this, even we have the centralized controller, sometimes we do not have the full control of the DER resources in each sub-microgrid. And we also did a lot of hardware in the loop validation test to validate the controller's performance in real-world environment. And for the optimal dispatch level, we mainly rely on robust optimization and stochastic optimization technologies, that is to address the uncertainties from the renewables and the low demands. And we also did some work on distributed optimization to distributedly coordinate the sub-microgrids energy management. And for the microgrid planning level, we also rely on robust and stochastic optimization algorithms. And we also develop a so-called probability-weighted robust optimization, which I will introduce later on. Okay, I will start from the control level. So generally speaking, the microgrid can operate at two modes. For the islanded modes, the objective is to control the voltage and the frequency and maintain the accurate power balancing. While for the grid-connected mode, the frequency and voltage are dominated as the main grid through the point of coupling connection, PCC. But in this case, we can still use the DERs to support the frequency and the voltage of the grid. But for the control architecture, generally we can divide it into centralized control, decentralized control, as well as the distributed control. So in our group, we mainly focus on the distributed control and decentralized control. Okay, this is a hierarchical control framework of a landed microgrid. So at the primary control level, the focus is on the inner loop control of the power converters or the generators, as well as the drop control. And the objective is to provide local voltage and frequency regulation, as well as the preliminary power sharing. This can be generally done in the decentralized control pattern. And going up in the secondary control level, the objective is to achieve the voltage and the frequency restoration and the accurate power power balancing, because the primary control cannot fully restore frequency and voltage. So for secondary control, it can be generally achieved in a centralized way, as well as a distributed way. So in our group, we mainly focus on the distributed secondary controller. And further going up, we have the tertiary controller, which is also known as energy management. The objective is to do the economic dispatch, optimal power flow. So this generally was achieved in the centralized way. And we can also implement this energy management in a distributed optimization pattern. Okay, so in our group, we mainly focus on the distributed control. So this is the general principle of the distributed control. So basically speaking, for this kind of control architecture, we do not need to have a centralized controller. And the one node, the node only communicates with its neighboring nodes. So they share the communication and the computational burden among the nodes. So compared with the centralized control architecture, this distributed control has a higher resilience, and it can support plug and play functionality, and also has a high scalability as well as data privacy. So this distributed control architecture is very suitable for our networked microgrid system, because as I mentioned earlier, the sub microgrids belong to different entities. So they do not, generally speaking, they do not share the information to each other, because in reality, these companies are competitors. So that motivates us to develop the distributed controller for the whole system. Okay, so for the, this is the illustration of the communication graph. So basically we can model it in the form of adjacent matrix of the graph. And for the distributed controllers, generally speaking, they can be divided into average consensus control and lead follower consensus control. For the average consensus control, the objective is to achieve the same state among all of the agents, which is the average of their initial states. And for the lead follower consensus control, the objective is to for the follower to achieve the same state of the leaders. This is the preliminary mathematical models. Okay, so we focus on the secondary, because the primary control is implemented in a decentralized way. So we mainly focus on the secondary controller design. So here I illustrate the principle of the secondary control. So basically this is a drop curve, which is to provide immediate power and active power and reactive power variation in response to the frequency and voltage changes. So the primary control essentially is a proportional control process. It cannot fully restore the voltage and the frequency. So on top of it, we have the secondary control, that is to move the drip curves so that we can achieve the accurate power balancing. Based on this, this is a mathematical principle of this controller. So this is the drip control for the frequency and voltage. Then we can take the derivative of them. So we have this one, and then we can formulate the problem as the integral of the frequency and the control variations. And after that, we can apply a consensus control rules for this so that we can achieve the distributed control of the frequency and the voltage. Okay, so we have, apart from the controller design, another important concern for the control is to validate their performance in the real world environment. So in our group, we have been developing several distributed controllers. And apart from that, we also did a so-called cross-national hardware in the loop test bed, which is jointly developed by our university and the University of Strathclyde in UK and G2E Lab in France. So basically the principle is that we have the microgrid system realized in the OpenRT system. OpenRT simulator in our lab, then we have two different controllers respectively in UK and France realized in Raspberry Pi IPI. And then we exchange the data through the cloud server. Here we use the RIS cloud server so that the controllers in UK and France can remotely control the microgrids in our lab. So we have validated our controllers in this platform. This is some general test results. This is the communication structure of the each agent on the Google remote protocol call. And we have tested a system of 10 distributed generators, which two controllers are located in UK and France. So each controller is for 5 DGs, and we have tested the step load change as well as the real world PV and the load profile case. So this is the general results, the frequency voltage as well as the real power output of the DG. As you can see, the DGs can achieve the consensus power sharing to regulate the voltage and the frequency within the allowed range. And for the distributed control, an important concern is the time delay and the communicational burden. So we also tested this. So we use the NS3 simulator to simulate the realistic communication delays. And we tested the impact of different communication delay on the controller performance. So generally, the larger the system cannot withstand a certain communication delay before it goes to unstable. So in order to mitigate this communication delay, a very simple approach is to tune the control gains. So generally, the conclusion is that if we have a larger control gain, we can convert faster, but this can only withstand a smaller time delay. On the contrary, if we have the smaller control gain, we can withstand a larger time delay, but it will convert much slower. So you can see that as long as the communication delay is beyond a certain limit, the whole system will become unstable. So our team members recently are also working on the time delayed controller design. And we also tested the communication failure scenarios. So at different time points, we disable different communication links, and we study the impact on the control performance. So general conclusion is that the failure of communication will reduce the connectivity of the whole graph, so it will affect the convergence speed. And for loss of the communication scenario, it will lead to inaccurate power sharing. For example, in 120 seconds, you can see that the bus 3 is disconnected from the system, so it cannot accurately share the power in the system. Okay, so for the distributed controllers, two major important concerns. One is the convergence speed. The other one is the communication burden. So following the earlier research works, we are developing enhanced controllers for the better performance of the distributed control. So this work focuses on the so-called event-triggered distributed control. The idea is that we only trigger the communication when there is a need to do so, depending on the system states. So for the frequency and the power, we design this event-triggered condition. And for voltage and the reactive power, this is the designed event-trigger condition. We also tested the controller in the hardware in the loop test bed, but this is just a local test bed. We do not involve the remote controllers in France and the UK. This is a 4DG case. So this is the control performance for the step load change. And you can see that the real power can be can convert the DGs of the real power output of the 4DGs can converge to consensus. And this is the communication requirement. The green line is the traditional control, meaning that all of the nodes keep communicating with each other. And this profiles indicates the communication time point of different DGs. So you can see that when there is a system state change, the whole system requires a very intensive communication. And after that, when the system becomes convergence, so you can see that they require much less communication. And after that, they even don't need any communication to maintain the current system state. So with this event-triggered controller, we can significantly reduce the communication and the computational burden of the system. Okay, then after that, in order to improve the convergence speed, we also developed the so-called finite time distributed controller. So this is the control rules. Generally speaking, the purpose is to further improve the control the convergence speed. I will skip the details of this and we can later on discuss during the roundtable discussion session. So this is a quick comparison between the finite time consensus control and the conventional linear consensus control. So you can see that we have a much faster convergence speed, almost doubled of the speed of the linear consensus control. Okay, so the above works are all for the islanded mode of the microgrid. While in the grid connected mode, the frequency and the voltage will be dominated by the main grid through the PCC. So in this case, we can utilize the DERs to support the voltage and the frequency to the main grid. So for the frequency support, we can utilize the DER resources such as the demand response, energy storage, as well as the diesel generators. While for the voltage control support, we can utilize the power converters of the DER resources, such as the the solar PV power converters, because as a power electronics device, these converters can flexibly inject, absorb reactive power from the grid. So it can provide a very flexible voltage control support. So along this, firstly, I will introduce our works on the frequency support from the energy storage system. The idea here is to aggregate the widespread small scale distributed energy storage system as a whole to participate in the load frequency control of the whole power system. And this is a general block diagram of the LFC of the power system as well as aggregated ESS. And we also designed a disturbance observer, which is to provide additional control signal for the better frequency control performance. And this is the general mathematical model of the problem. Okay, so in this work, we have designed a lead follower controller, where the leader will receive the LFC control reference signal and send these signals to its followers. And the followers will achieve the LFC power reference signal, and in the meantime, achieve the consensus state of charge SOC. So this is the model for the leader, and this is the model for the follower. And the metrics to describe the communication graph. And this is the proposed control load. As I mentioned, we have two objectives. One is to achieve the LFC power reference signal. Another one is to achieve the consensus SOC so that all of the batteries can continue to provide the frequency support online. And this is the simulation results giving the highly volatile solar PV fluctuation profile. We have the corresponding power output of the distributed ESS. And as you can see that after 600 seconds, the system reaches the convergence. So all of the ESS share the consensus SOC depending on their capacity. And this is a control performance in terms of the frequency. So this is a conventional LFC scheme without energy storage system support and without the disturbance observer. And this is our approach. You can see that the frequency becomes much more smooth. Okay, so this is our work for the ESS-based frequency support. Apart from the ESS, the thermal statically controllable loads, so-called TCL, is another good resource for frequency support. This is because, first of all, the TCL shares a significant amount of the power load in the building environment, especially in Singapore. I can see that for the built environment, more than half of the power load come from the HVAC. Besides, the thermal energy has a relatively larger inertia. So if we can adjust their temperature settings, it can provide a relatively longer support for the system frequency. So this is a mathematical model of the temperature dynamics of the TCL. So it depends on the heat exchange with the ambient as well as the thermal energy from the air conditioner. So in our work, we consider the viable frequency air conditioner, which means that the power state is a continuous variable rather than a binary variable. And this is a model for the comfort zone of the TCL. So based on that, we can formulate the state-space model of the whole TCL. Okay, so based on the TCL, we designed a lead follower distributed controller for the TCLs to provide frequency control. So basically speaking, the leader will decide the total power increase or decrease to satisfy the system requirements and send the signals to its followers to achieve. So this is, generally speaking, this is a piecewise frequency control for the leader. So if the frequency violates the operational limits, we will activate the drop control for the TCLs to increase and decrease power demand. And if the frequency is within the range, we can restore the comfort level of the TCLs. In other words, when the frequency is within the limit, we can restore the temperature so that we do not affect the residents' comfort. And this is the general process of the consensus controller. And this is the testing results. So the red curves, the blue curves is the LFC, is the frequency of the traditional LFC. And the red curve is the frequency with our TCL support. So you can see that the frequency becomes much more smooth. and this is the power increase and decrease of the TCLs. Okay, so furthermore, the modern buildings also have the rooftop solar PV, especially in Singapore, most significant amount of the residential buildings have the rooftop solar PV. So we can further aggregate all of the buildings together to provide ancillary service to the system, considering the HVAC as well as their rooftop solar PV. So the idea here is that we want to aggregate a large number of buildings together to follow the system dispatch requirements, considering the fluctuated solar PV output. So you can see that this is the total, the green curve is the total power output of the rooftop solar PV. And in order to follow the power, power dispatch signal, we can adjust our TCL loads to compensate this fluctuating PV output so that we can achieve a net steady state, a more smooth power, a net power generation to the grid. Okay. So this is a designed two-level distributed controller. The key innovation point here is an initial value updating scheme for different agents. And this is a testing results for the convergency performance. So you can see that after a certain time of period, the whole building clusters can achieve a constant, approximately constant power output to the grid. And this is a comfort state of the TCLs. Okay, the above work is for the frequency control support and for voltage control support, as I mentioned earlier, we can utilize the power converters to provide a flexible reactive power support to the system. Because for the low voltage distribution grid, the resistance to reactance ratio is higher, it's much higher than the transmission grid. So the real power fluctuation may also lead to a voltage fluctuation and even a voltage violation. So in this case, we can utilize the power converters to provide flexible and fast reactive power support. So we can consider two types of the converter. One is for solar PV, another one is energy storage. And for energy storage, it can both charge and discharge. But for solar PV, it can only generate power. So the available reactive power capacity of the inverters depends on the real power of the converter. Okay, so generally speaking, as long as the real power is below the apparent capacity of the inverters, so we will have the Q capacity to provide this support. So along this idea, for the real-time voltage and the VIR control, we designed a three-level controller. So for the bottom level, we have a so-called ramp rate control. The purpose is to smooth the voltage fluctuation locally. This is essentially a kind of the filter. And in the second level, we have the droop control. That is to provide immediate Q support to the system as long as there is voltage changes. And in level three, it is a distributed control. So the objective is to regulate the voltage to the acceptable range as long as the voltage violates the limits. And in this study, we use the so-called dynamic consensus to dynamically change the agent's status depending on the voltage magnitude. Okay, we did both simulation tests and the hardware in the loop validation test. So this is the result we tested on the 33 bus system. This is the voltage profile, original voltage profile. You can see that many of the buses have violated the operational limits. And with our controllers, you can see that the voltages are all regulated within the operational limits. And this is the effectiveness of the ramp rate control. This is the red curve, the real power fluctuation, and the blue curve is the reactive is the reactive power output of the converter. So you can see that with this ramp rate control, the voltage fluctuation curve becomes much more smooth than the original voltage fluctuation curve. And we also tested the controller in the power hardware in the load test. So in my earlier slides, the hardware loop in the test is the controller hardware in the loop. So there is no real power. So for this, we have a real world load bank, 10 kilowatt load bank, as well as a 15 kVA converter to emulate the solar PV power. They are interfaced with a 90 kVA power interface, and we tested the whole approach in this seven bus system. And this is the power hardware in the loop testing results. So the red curve is the hardware inverter. You can see that it has more like harmonics. And we also studied the stability of the controllers during the parameter tuning. This is the control gains tuning results. So for different control gains, the system becomes unstable. Okay, next I will go to the operation of the microgrid. So generally speaking, the operation focus on the energy dispatch and avoid reactive power optimization. So for the microgrid, basically we have these controllable variables for active power resources, reactive power resources. And the parameters, we have low demand, renewable energy resources, as well as the electricity price. They are all uncertain parameters. So one of the major challenges for operation, for microgrid operation is uncertainties. Okay, so in our research group, we mainly focus on this so-called two-stage coordinated operation framework. So because different DERs, they have different special characteristics. So the principle is that we want to coordinate the different DERs so that they can compensate with each other in different time scales on against the uncertainty. So basically speaking, for the first stage, we can dispatch the slower responding DERs in relatively long time scales, for example, from the hours to day ahead. And the second stage, we dispatch the faster responding more flexible DERs in the relatively shorter time scale, for example, 15 minutes to an hour ahead. And these two stages are coordinated in a two-stage optimization model. So after that, the first stage decisions will be implemented before the uncertainty realized, and this will be fixed in the second stage. And for the second stage, the variables will be re-optimized and implemented after the uncertainty realized. So in this case, the second stage decision is a recourse action for the first stage. And for the specific optimization methodologies, basically we have stochastic programming and the robust optimization. I believe everybody here is familiar with these two optimization technologies. So generally speaking, the stochastic programming is to optimize under expectation. So this is the objective function. And the robust optimization and to optimize under the worst case. Okay, so the stochastic programming needs a probability distribution function to generate different scenarios. But the advantage is this approach is relatively simpler for formulation and the solution. The robust optimization do not need the probabilistic density function. What it needs is the interval prediction of the uncertain variable. It does not rely on the PDF, and importantly, it can achieve the full robustness within the uncertainty set. Disadvantage is sometimes it has some problems cannot be formulated in this robust optimization. Okay, so along this, the first work I would like to introduce on the coordinated operation is the price-based demand response. and the microturbine in the microgrid. So the price-based demand response is to use the price as a signal to manage the load. After receiving the electricity price signal, the customers may respond to it by adjusting their load demand. So generally speaking, a higher price will lead to a lower load and vice versa. So for the price-based demand response, generally speaking, the price signal has to be sent to the customers in a relatively long lead time so that the customers can be well notified and prepared to adjust their load. So in this case, the price-based DR is a relatively slowing response, responding DERs. So here we design a two-stage operation framework. In the first stage, we dispatch, we optimize the price-based demand response, that is the price signal. And in the second stage, we dispatch the microturbine in the microgrid, which has a high startup and ramping speed. So the two stages are coordinated together to compensate each other against the uncertainty. So here we proposed a two-stage robust optimization model. Objective function is to maximize the total profit considering the electricity selling revenue as well as the operation cost. And the uncertain variables are modeled as this uncertainty set, including the wind turbine and solar PV. And importantly, the demand response is itself is also uncertain because not all the customers will respond to the price signal. So we also need to model this uncertainty of the price-based DERs. And this is the result. This is the internal forecasting of the uncertain variables. And this is day-ahead price-based demand response decisions. You can see that with this, with the price signal, the load curves have been changed. And this is the hourly ahead microgrid dispatch results. And we also compare our approach with the traditional single stage operation and the deterministic operation. And obviously compared with the single stage operation, we can achieve higher profit. And compared with the deterministic operation, we can achieve high robustness under the uncertainty. Second work is to coordinate the energy storage and the direct load control. Direct load control is a kind of incentive-based demand response. We can directly cut or increase the load demand as we need if we have signed a contract with the customers. So here, the energy storage system compared with the DLC is relatively slower. So we dispatch the energy storage in hourly ahead time frame. And we dispatch the DLC in 15 minutes ahead. So for the ESS, we also proposed the economic model to quantify the benefit and the cost of the ESS charging and discharging. And this is a model for the ESS operation. So we also, based on this, the problem is also formulated as a robust optimization model. And this is the testing results. Okay, so here I just illustrate the worst case that we obtained from this model, which is the worst wind power output, meaning that under this wind power profile, the we have the least profit. So the robust optimization is to optimize under this worst case. Okay, so all of the above only focus on the electricity network, but nowadays we are integrating other energy carriers, such as the thermal energy systems. Especially in Singapore, we are doing the district cooling in commercial areas as well as in the our campus. So for the multi, that will lead to the so-called multi-energy microgrid. Apart from the electricity network, we have the heating network, cooling network. Okay, so in order to operate the multi-energy microgrid, first of all, we need to model the thermal part of the system. That includes the district heat network, the thermal model of the building, the load, so that we can have a coupled electric thermal network. And following the coordinated operation scheme, we can also design the two-stage coordinated operation for the multi-energy microgrid. And this is even more necessary because the thermal system and the electric system, they have a very different inertia. Generally, the thermal load has a large thermal inertia, so they can be dispatched in the longer time scale, and the electric components can be dispatched in the shorter time scale. And this is the general mathematical models. And this is the general solution process. So in the first stage, we dispatch the on and off status of the CHP units, as well as the electric boiler and the charging discharging power of the ESS. And in the second stage, we can dispatch the CHP power output and the electric boiler's output. And this is the day ahead dispatch results, and this is the intraday dispatch results. So we also compared our method with the existing practices. One is the single stage deterministic approach. Second one is single stage stochastic approach. And third one is two stage deterministic approach. So apparently our method can achieve a balance between the operation cost minimization as well as the constraint satisfaction. Okay, so, and for the multi-energy microgrid, we can also rely on the multi-energy demand response to operate the whole system. Okay, so in this work, we consider the internal indoor temperature control for the thermal load and the price-based demand response for the electric load. So because they have different responding speed. So in the first stage, day ahead frame, we can dispatch the PBDR and the thermal energy storage, because thermal energy storage, they relatively have a higher inertia. And in the second stage, we dispatch the CCHP's power output as well as the indoor temperature control. And this is the mathematical model for day ahead and the intraday optimization problems. So this is the result. You can see that for day ahead, the electric electric load profile has been changed. And this is the thermal ESS power output. And in the intraday operating frame, the CHP power output, as well as the indoor temperature changes. And this is the corresponding thermal load for the indoor temperature changes. And we also developed a GUI prototype to realize all of our methodologies for multi-energy operation. Okay, well, all of the above work are optimized in a centralized way. We may also need the distributed optimization to coordinate different sub microgrids among each other, because as I discussed earlier, in practice, these sub microgrids may not be fully controlled by a single dispatcher. Okay, so the idea here is we studied a networked DC, hybrid AC-DC microgrid. The idea here is for each individual microgrid, we dispatch their DERs locally, and each microgrid will just share the information with the neighbors to minimize the total power loss in the transmission grid of the system. And this was formulated as a distributed, robust optimization model and solved by ADMM algorithms after the model convexification and the linearization. This is some of the results. I may skip of this because of time is quite limited. Okay, after the active power and energy dispatch, the next topic is on the voltage or reactive power optimization. So generally speaking, the idea is similar. We can also dispatch different queue resources in different time scales to counteract the uncertainties. So specifically, as I mentioned earlier, we can utilize the power converters of the renewable energy resources to respond in the shorter time scale. Okay, so here I designed a two-stage voltage VAR regulation framework. In the first stage, hourly, we can dispatch the capacitor banks and the OLTCs, which are mechanical equipment and very relatively slow in responding speed. And in 15 minutes ahead time frame, we dispatch the converters. So this is control model, and this is a corresponding mathematical model. This is the mapping relationship to convert the physical problem to the mathematical problem. And in this case, we formulate the problem into the stochastic programming model. And this is an objective function. And based on the beta distribution, we can sample different scenarios. And after that, we can reduce the scenarios using a scenario reduction algorithm. And finally, we can convert the stochastic model into the deterministic equivalent model, and we can solve it efficiently. And this is the result. The objective is to minimize the power loss of the day. And this is the dispatch results of the first stage mechanical equipment, OLTC, and the capacitor bank. And this is the dispatch results for the power converters in 15 minutes time interval. So you can see that in both time intervals, hourly interval and the 15 minutes interval, the voltage can be regulated within the operational limit. Okay, so this is the work for the inverter-based voltage regulation. Well, traditionally, most of the existing works is to minimize the power loss of the system during the voltage regulation. So this is a single objective optimization. But it has been founded that the power loss and the voltage deviation conflict with each other. So it's sensible to develop a multi-objective optimization approach to systematically study the conflict. So in this work, we first of all propose a voltage deviation index, which is called load-weighted voltage index. Then we develop a multi-objective robust optimization model to study the conflict between the voltage deviation and the power loss minimization. And in this work, we have tested four different kinds of multi-objective algorithms, including this CWS, CEC, AWS, as well as the normal boundary intersection. So the model is converted into the robust optimization model. And this is the results. As you can clearly see, the power loss and the voltage deviation, they are conflict with each other. And this is the Pareto solutions. Conclusions is that, okay, so basically speaking, AWS and NBI algorithms are better than the other two. So if you're interested, you can go to this paper and take more details. Okay.
徐元教授您好，就是因为我们后面还有那个讨论的环节，你能在五分钟之内大概介绍一下那个 planning 那一块吗？
好，那我好的，我们这个 hierarchy control 我们可以等到那个讨论的时候具体讨论。
好的。
Okay, I will go to the planning part. Basically speaking, the planning is to optimally place the DERs in the microgrid. So, in this work, we consider the heterogeneous ESS.Including the thermal ESS and the electrical ESS. And for the distributed generators, we also consider different types of the generators, including the electrical generators and the CCHP units, as well as the intermittent renewable energy resources based ESS. The problem is very straightforward. We want to minimize the total investment cost subject to the operational limits, network constraints, and the component constraints.And the decision variables are the optimal sizing, siting, as well as the type of the components, as well as the installation years. Okay, so we further developed a two-stage coordinated approach. That is to decide the planning decisions considering the operational limits of the system.So the first stage is the planning stage, the second stage is the operation stage. So the total objective is the expected net present value of the investment cost as well as the operation cost. So this is a result for the ESS planning. This is the DG planning. We consider different types of DG, CCHP units, electric boiler type A, type B, electric chiller type A, type B.As well as the solar PV, wind turbine type A and B. And this is for this work is for the heterogeneous energy storage, electrical energy storage, and the thermal energy storage. Mathematical model, we have considered a risk averse objective function. And this is the planning results for different phases of the planning horizon. And this is required heat storage tank. Importantly, we do not need a cooling heat storage because the cooling demand is much higher. So there's no need to store them. We can directly consume the cooling energy. And in terms of the planning study, we have also developed some algorithms to cope with the existing disadvantages of existing algorithms. So this is so-called a probability-weighted robust optimization. Idea is to model the probability of the uncertainty set. And based on that, we also developed an effective solution algorithm. So compared with the traditional robust optimization, the so-called probability robust optimization can achieve this one is actually the investment cost, can achieve a smaller investment cost while full robustness for the operation no constraints. Okay, I think this is the end of my presentation. If you are interested, you can go to our publications, which contain all of the details of our research works. Okay, with this, I end my presentation. Thank you very much. 不好意思啊，有点超了。
好的，非常感谢这个徐岩教授的这个非常精彩的这个关于微电网和分布式能源的这个演讲。那么另外呢，我想提醒一下大家，就是今天的这个在线的 webinar 呢，其实我们是在 YouTube、还有 Facebook、还有 Twitter 上面进行同步的直播，所以如果这个 Zoom 这个群如果已经满员的话呢，就请大家登录到这个我们的其他的这个直播平台去观看直播。那具体的链接呢，我已经贴在了这个 chat 这个的讨论区里面。那么我们现在马上就进入到第二个环节，就是圆桌讨论环节。那这一部分呢由姚瑞博士来主持。姚瑞博士目前是在美国的阿贡国家实验室工作。那我们现在就把时间交给姚瑞博士。
大家好，我是姚瑞。那么很高兴今天来主持这个圆桌讨论的环节。我首先是非常感谢徐岩老师刚才非常精彩而且干货满满的这个技术报告。那么今天的圆桌讨论环节呢，我们也邀请到了陆宁老师和顾伟老师是来参与讨论。那么再次欢迎两位老师。
非常感谢姚瑞啊。
谢谢。
谢谢。那么关于徐岩老师的刚才的这个技术报告，相信两位老师也有很多感兴趣的问题，希望想能够进行讨论。那么可不可以请两位老师分别问徐岩老师一个您最感兴趣的问题，然后请徐老师回答。要不然我们先请陆宁老师问问题，然后徐老师回答，之后请顾伟老师问问题，然后徐岩老师回答。
好的，首先那个我觉得那个徐老师在这个方面做的东西还是挺广泛的。我有一个问题想问，主要是那个你现在建模的时候，这些模型呢，用现场的数据进行过验证？
好的，谢谢陆老师。是这样子，就是说这个我们是分为那个就是在控制和这个运行和这个规划方面。先从控制方面的讲的话，我们这个控制的参数很多都是来自于那个就是说现有设备的一些这个标准参数。然后的话，我们的控制器是在这个叫做就是说硬件在环的仿真平台上进行的这个验证，然后我们也考虑了这种现实的这种time delay。然后这个time delay我们是专门用了一个就是仿真time delay的工具叫 NS3 去仿真的，所以整个的话控制器的 performance 是在一个近似于真实的环境中去验证的。然后运行的话因为涉及到一些这个机组的这种费用成本函数，那么这个函数的话我们很多是来自于文献，因为有的时候这个费用成本函数的话这个供应商他们并不是很愿意去公布。 然后的话规划的话，规划也是跟这个运行啊、比较类似，就是说我们有它的这个投资的这个成本，有这个运行的这个费用参数，以及这个单位投资的这个成本。单位投资的成本，这个我们也是根据现有的大部分的文献去搜集啊，包括单位这个，包括这个 ESS 啊，每一个这个兆瓦时它大概的这个成本是多少。所以的话这个从数据的安排大概是这样子。
因为我看了一下你前面那一部分讲过，就是在这个岛屿上面你有八个微网，对吧？那么我就说在建模的时候你因为我们也在做同样方面的一些工作，我们发现就是说你现在的一些功能在你今后 EMS 中要应用的时候，它本身的一些信号呢是那些设备所不能够达到的。所以我就是想问一下子，你是否用了你在那个八个微网中的那个硬件设备进行过一些验证？比如说这些信号你在，因为你现在这个控制器，我假设你是根据你的算法实行在那个Raspberry Pi 或者说这种BeagleBone 上面的，而不是它本身的那个 inverter unit 的那个控制器，因为这两者之间的区别还是很大的。因为 inverter unit 上那个控制器，它所产生的那个信号才是真正的信号。
对，没错。那么具体上来讲的话，我们是这样，我们这个就是说这个八个这个紫微网的话，目前的话我们现在暂时建的首期是有四个，首期是有四个已经建成的，是有四个。那么我们组具体参与的其中一个是跟这个Rolls-Royce 做的，然后他们的这个的话，他们是有一个叫做德国的一个diesel generator 叫 MTU。所以的话我们是在他们的这个平台上去进行这个验证。然后刚才讲的有一部分内容就是包括那个 hardware in the loop， 那个目前是在实验室级别。然后呢在这个具体上的岛屿，实际上我们最近一段时间吧，应该是在疫情之前正要去做这个叫做这个 hardware in the loop 的 test， 所以那个时候就会真正的把这个控制器发给他们在现场的那个发电机。这个是对发电机的方面。对于您刚才讲的那个 inverter 是这样， inverter 我们用的是这个叫做3-phase 的这个 inverter， 所以的话这个 inverter 是这个 inverter 的话就是怎么讲，就是那个 power hardware in the loop test 的时候，这个的话这个信号是真实的电信号，这个信号是真实的电信号。然后我们是把它这个然后整个系统是在这个 OpenRT 系统上去做，但是这个信号的话是一个真正的信号。对，
谢谢。
好的，谢谢骆老师和薛老师。那么有请顾伟老师，你有没有什么问题想和徐岩老师进行交流？
那个徐老师啊，我还是真是刚刚仔细听了这个报告，还是有些问题想跟你这边这个交流一下的。因为我本人的话呢也是在做那个微电网分布式控制这一块的一些工作啊。
是的。
所以说对分布式控制这一块的话呢就是比较感兴趣啊，我也看过你的这个一些论文啊，大家做的工作的话呢在这个方向上还是比较一致的。但是呢一直还是有一个我想讨论的一个问题啊，就是说这个分布式控制的话呢，虽然它就是说虽然不需要主控制器，对不对？那么对于隐私保护啊等等也比较好，那么从整个控制结构上来讲的话呢可靠性也是高一些。但是的话呢据我了解一直是没有在这个实际的工程中啊进行相关的一些应用的。就这边的话呢我想就是说听听你的这一些这个意见啊，就是说咱们这个分布式控制的话呢，如果想在实际工程中应用，那么还存在什么样的这样一些问题？这是第一个问题。第二个就是想了解一下，这个如果说是用分布式控制的方式去做，那么我们在控制器和通讯方面的这样一些成本会比我们集中控制就是说来的要低吗？主要是这两个问题。
好，谢谢您。对，我完全同意您说的，就是说目前来讲的话分布式控制在工业当中的尤其是电力的这个工业应用吧，可能相对来讲比较少。那么在其他的包括这个什么机器人啊无人机这个方面还是应用很多。那么我们对于我们这个就是说为什么要去研究分布式控制呢，大概是对我来讲大概是有两个契机吧。那么第一个契机的话首先是这一个项目。 这个项目它本身是一个叫做怎么说，是一个 R&D 的平台，它就是让很多的这个本地的这个工业的这个就是说公司吧啊，去 showcase 他们的这个产品以及他们的这种控制的这种啊系统啊，验证他们的这个 performance， 从而的话可以更好的去推广给这个相关其他的这个国家。那么所以的话，整个这个平台的话，当时在设计的时候，因为它这几个子维网彼此之间呢都是属于各自的公司，然后的话虽然他们都是通过一个这个中央母线连接起来，但是每个公司实际上在做自己的事，在做自己的事，然后他们很多的时候是不太愿意去share 他的这个通信的share 这个包括他的一些数据去给其他人的话。所以的话这个时候我们当时就是觉得这个在这种场景下，那么分布式控制可能是会比较需要，可能是会比较需要。那么我这个每一个子维网或者说每一个节点只要管好自己的这个事情，这个当然是从 network 的 microgrid 系统上去走，只要管好自己的事情，跟相邻的这个节点做一些通信。那么至于在你这个微网内部当中，如果说我们具体去看不同的这个 DR， 那么现实中的话不同的 DR 也可能属于这个不同的这个叫做什么拥有者，或者是不同的这个 stakeholder， 他们之间也可能也不愿意去说集中在一起去控制，然后也没有一个这种所谓的这种集中型的这个控制的 architecture。 所以的话就是说从怎么讲，从问题的角度上来说，我说这个问题是一直存在的，但至于说这个工业界到底什么时候才去采纳这个东西，我觉得可能也是分场景。比如说对于我们这个系统，可能分布式控制是非常好的一个选择所以我们在跟公司合作的时候，现在这个之前跟他们讲这个分布式控制，他们可能也觉得说如果我们能够做集中的，为什么要做分布的但是就是说针对这个不同的工程应用的场景，那么可能对于你这个场景，那么就是说分布式可能是会更适合所以的话现在就是我们在跟这个公司的话，我们就是在这个岛上去布置一些这种分布式的这种控制的这个方法然后这个是我的观点，就是说针对应用来讲的话我觉得就是说我个人觉得就是说问题是确实是存在的，但是至于说这个公司根据它实际的这个场景，它可能有什么样的选择那么我觉得就是说是要根据实际情况去看的然后您说的那个通信的这个需求我觉得这个问题非常好，我们也遇到这个问题，就是说实际上从这个通信的角度来讲，分布式的这个通信的架构其实并不见得比这个叫做什么集中型的这个通信架构一是要简单，二是要更节省成本我们也觉得并不是这样，实际上甚至有可能还这个说更复杂一点，它的这个链路等等那么我认为就是说可能分布式控制的这个就是说出发点不光是这个通信系统，它应该是一种叫做什么信息的利用方式，或者说数据的交换方式或者说是怎么讲，应该讲叫做这个 data privacy 或一种信息的利用方式。它本质上来讲，我们依然可以是用一个集中型的叫做通信网络去实现分布式控制的事情。所以我觉得就是如果是单纯从通信系统的什么成本复杂度来讲的话，可能不见得说分布式是更有优势，但是我觉得就是还是回归到您第一个问题，就是说根据实用的场景，那么可能在某种情况下我们必须只能够这种信息的方式，或者是这种通信的这个方式对，大概是这样我的观点。
刚刚网络有点顿，我没有听得很清楚就是您刚刚讲的是准备在这个新加坡这个岛上面，我通讯的话呢还是这种集中通讯的方式，但是我控制的话呢是采用分布式的控制，是吧？
对对对对对对。
就我可能只分享部分的信息，但是呢因为他可能要考虑原来的就是说我集中控制，我需要的时候他也可以去用，所以说的话呢就是说通讯链路的布置的话呢还是说这种集中式的方式。喂
喂不好意思，我刚才好像没太听清楚
没事没事了我刚刚听清楚你说的了
好的好的，谢谢。
好的谢谢郭老师和徐老师那么下面一个问题呢是主要是给郭老师和陆老师的那么因为今天我看到非常有意思的一个事情是，就我们的三位嘉宾分别在新加坡、美国和中国工作。那么刚才呢，徐老师的报告主要 介绍了这个、以及南洋理工大学主导的这个微电网的示范项目。那么顾老师和陆老师，就是可否分别介绍一下中国和美国的微电网和 DER 方面的工程实践到了一个怎样的一个阶段，那么有没有什么比较代表性的工程，那么先请顾老师分享一下，然后之后是陆老师。
好，那个大家能听到我的这个说话吗？我这边有的时候好像听着声音有点断断续续。 OK 的吧？
我是可以，
不是听到我说话吗？
可以，我可以听到。哎，您刚才听清楚我的问题了吗？
听清楚了。就是说国内那个微电网工程这边这一块的一些情况嘛，对吧？
对对对，
是这样的，就是我简单的介绍一下啊。我们2008年左右就开始的话呢，就是有一些微电网示范的工程，这个包括单微网的，也包括一些多联供的。那么其实是在2011年左右，国家开始启动这个当时叫做863重点专项，现在的话呢是这个叫做重点研发计划了，全部改成重点研发计划了。那么863和这个科技支撑项目的时候的话，启动了一大批的这种微电网示范工程啊。那么我们早期也参与过一些，主要是以这个海岛型的这种独立型的这种微网示范工程，或者说是这种边防啊、边远山区啊一些这种独立型的这个微网示范工程为主。当然个别的话呢也有一些联网的。在那之后的话呢，其实是建了一批的话呢，但是国内当时关于这个因为微电网建设的成本也比较高，然后这个商业模式的话呢一直没有很好的商业模式出来，所以说大部分其实是以这种示范工程为主。那么其实这一波建完之后的话呢，在2016年之后的话呢，国家能源局其实又进行了一次比较大的这种推动啊。那么当时我印象中是新增了这个微电网的试点工程的话呢，大概有28个，然后多能互补的工程的话呢是23个，还有的话呢就是这个我们这边叫做这个智慧能源的试点工程和增量配电的这样一个试点工程。那么智慧能源的示范工程有55个，那么前3个的话呢，其实无论是微电网、多能互补还有这个智慧能源，很多其实最终它其实都是一个微电网。那么增量配电里面的话呢也有很多是这个微电网的示范工程，所以国内目前建成的这个微电网示范工程的话呢，大大小小的其实这个几百有了很多就是说上网的就是说直接上网的。我们讲这个微电网示范工程的话呢，肯定还是就是说包含一些分布电源符合储能，然后能够实现这个自治管理的我有这个控制中心的这种另外其实到了2020年左右的话呢，我们国家又提了一堆就是说这种示范工程的建设项目，包括的话呢就是这个分布式能源的这种微网而且这个里面其实很多这个示范工程里面的话呢都提了这个多能互补，而且的话呢就是规模也要求是就是比较相对来讲要比较大一些比较多一开始的规模都会变得很大。你比如说去年建成的这个河南省这个鹤壁市，它建了国家经济开发区里面建了一个示范工程，那么它是风光气储充这样一个一体化的这样一个示范工程。那么分布电源的话呢就有6.2兆瓦这个2兆瓦的风机和4.2兆瓦的这种光伏。那么另外的话呢，我们现在这个示范工程的话呢，就是国内也呈现出一种就是我各种类型的设备都希望上，原来的话就是风光储这些，现在的话呢就是希望说这种这个各种各种样子的这种 蓝牙电池，对吧？还有这个充电桩，充电桩，啊，还有的话呢，就是这种各种各样的储能，对吧？比如说我们在同里这边建的这种，有这种热储，还有的话呢，就是说空气压缩储能，对不对？还有电池储能等等，啊，不同类型的这种储能都要包含进去，就希望它的话呢能够更加多样化。那么现在今年这两年立项的一些项目的话呢，慢慢的就是说我们国家可能对这个氢能方面这两年比较关注，所以说很多这种含有氢能的这样一个微网项目的话呢都在立项，都在示范。马上下周我要评审一个项目，就是新一批重点研发计划里面有好几个都是关于这个含氢能的，但他没有讲说是微网，但其实大家都知道这就是一个微网。所以这个是现在的态势，国内发展的话呢，就是这个微电网示范工程的话呢，往着这个大容量大规模，然后的话呢这个里面的分布电源的形态多样化，另外的话呢就是多能互补，冷热电联供这种方式去进行发展。另外我们所了解到的就是说这个控制方式的话呢，实际上来讲呢，刚刚徐老师也讲了两层控制啊，三层控制等等。国内目前建成的微网的话呢，控制方式都还是比较简单的。这个一般的话呢，也就是用到这个 VF 控制啊，或者说是 PQ 控制。我们就是主从式的为主嘛。像大家前面所提到的这种，比如说下垂控制啊，以下垂控制为主来实现的这种分布式上对等啊，就目前在一些实验室的微网里面的话呢会有，但是话在示范工程里面的话呢还没有见到。还有的话呢就是关于这个，我看之前发给我那个调研里面也讲了一些这个微电网标准的，现在国内也很注重这个微电网的标准的这个制定，我们自己微电网标准制定了很多。另外的话呢就是关于这个REC 的一些标准，现在这个中国电科院主要是中国电科院主导，然后在 REC 那边也搞了几个标准组来制定一些国际方面的这样一些微电网的标准，大概是这样一个情况。国内我就简单先介绍一下，大家如果说有什么想了解的，待会儿我们还可以再做探讨。
好的，感谢顾老师。那么陆老师你有请您分享。
我觉得美国这个方面他在做微电网的时候，我记得就是在2013年我刚到北卡的时候呢，由于有一个项目，那个项目就是大概是第一个针对微网的，它是微网的实习，就是一个 demonstration， 它的主要就是选取了就是在社区这个层面和那个就是像岛屿啊，或者说像这种就是厂矿这个层面上面做微网，然后选了几个 team 大家来进行一下，就是有点像研究这个层面上的那个就看这个微网应该用什么样的架构，然后在同现有这个保护之间的那个协调性上面应该是怎样的。它主要呢并没有让你去做真正的实现，而是把那个街区的那个就是它的接线图或者是复合给你，然后让你提供这几个备选方案，然后在这些备选方案之下呢你可以建模，然后呢看一看在各种就是控制方式下面是不是能够实现它的那个就是各项指标的提高，主要就是在停电的情况下你是不是能够缩短停电的时间，能不能够增加就是负荷，就是被 serve 的这个数量和那个它的那个停电时间是不是能够缩短，它想做一个综合的比对，看在什么scale 下面实现微网呢实际上是最经济的。然后这个项目结束以后，大部分 DOE 它就开始向那个就是各个企业注资，然后呢希望他们能够进行一下那个就是自己的一些短期的实验项目。那么这个呢一般情况下军方的项目可能也是有的，但是我们这些就是不会了解太多。一般民用的项目呢它基本上就是同各个 utility 合作，在夏威夷啊，或者说在这种海岛上面，或者说是在一些就是 utility 自己建实验场，然后选取一些那个 critical load， 好比说是那个就是 fire station， 就是消防队这类的，然后他建一个小规模的围网，然后进行运行的准备。然后这个时候呢，我觉得主要推动力就是你有很多的那个solar， 所以从 EERE DOE 的这个 solar office， 它是最希望实现微网的，因为在这种情况下它才能够增加它的 PV 的 penetration， 因为它实现了 PV 的附加值，它不只是在入网的情况下可以做，而且在那个离网的情况下也可以能够 supply load， 然后增加整个这个系统的 resiliency 和 reliability。所以在这种情况下呢，就是 ERE 开始就是接，我觉得它很多的那个项目就是支持在那个配网上面建立微网，然后实现它 PV 那个能就是能够最大化的应用。那在这种情况下，很多微网的那个它的设计就会同这个电力电子紧密联系，因为那个 PV 它有个特点，它不是像传统电机一样它是有 inertia 的，它是个 low inertia system。那么在这种情况下，你要能够做到微网的那个调节呢，你就必须要那个 PV 同其他的那个资源进行合作。那其中最主要的就是那个电力，就是电池。然后现在这几年电就是那个就是电动汽车的发展，它也有一定的充电负荷，对吧？所以这两方面加在一起，现在那个微网它发展的就比较快。我们最近拿到的那个 DOE 的项目，实际上就是让这种不同层面的微网，从家庭上的那个微网到那个社区的微网，再到整个这个feeder level， 就是整个这个供电线上的这种 megawatt 上面这个微网，它到底能够对整个系统起多大的作用，它要进行一个就是一下精细的仿真。但是我们在这个过程中就发现啊，我们之前做就是也是做那个就是电力系统的这个energy management system 为主的，但是我们现在发现就是最主要的问题实际上并不在这个 energy management system， 或者说我们直控还是那个分布控制，而是这个 PV 它本身的这个性能。因为很多的 inverter 它是不同厂家来生产的，它本身你能够控制这个参数是很有限的，它不是说我们希望它能够在这个 power level 上运行它就可以的。然后这个电池也是同样的，所以我们发现就是在这个今后微网它发展的最大的问题实际上是怎么 simulate 这个 dynamic， 然后呢这个 load 的 dynamic 怎么样合在一起，来发现你在这个微网运行的时候你的那个负荷变动的范围在多大的情况下这个微网可以支撑，然后呢你这个 voltage 它的那个 stability 它是不是能够由这个 PV 这个或者是电池来提供。所以说我们发现很多这种问题它实际上是要求我们做非常精致的模型，而且要经过系统就是整个系统的那个进行一些实验，在现场进行就是各种运行状况的实验，反过来验证这个模型是不是能够 reflect 它这个 performance。 所以现在我觉得这个微网现在发展这个阶段，所以我们系统的来说就是大家都在仿真，但真正在系统里运行还是以那个传统电机，就是你有那个就是 diesel engine 或者 CHP 这种微网，实际上跟以前那种就是可供电方式没有太大的区别。但真正那个变革它要来临的时候呢，实际上是你今后能够由 PV 和这个电池来主导这个供电，然后实现调频和那个就是那个电压的自足。这个我觉得还是在今后这两三年之间可能要发展的比较快的这个就在建模在电力系统这方面吧，我觉得可能这个是我们现在在追逐这个目标吧。
好的，谢谢陆老师。那么下面一个问题想请各位老师探讨的呢，是就是关于这个微电网和 DER 并网，包括这个需求侧。因为我们也注意到这个新的2018版的1547标准以及各国自己的标准，对这个并网都提出了一系列的要求或者说希望。那么各位老师可否谈一谈这个这些新的发展包括标准对主网，就是我们的大电网的运行和或者是运营有什么挑战或者机遇。那么请各位老师三位老师可以畅所欲言。
你希望我们谁先说呢？
陆老师你先说吧。
对，陆老师先说吧，要不
我刚刚已经说，我就觉得从现在这个方式来讲，就是说，我觉得这些技术上面的要求实际上，没有特别大的 barrier， 但是从 utility 的这个角度来讲呢，他最关心的实际上一个是钱，就是说他本身是不希望那个 Bbond 能够进入运行的，因为这样的话他就是用户自产自销会影响到他的利润，对吧？那么第二个呢，是因为你微网运行的时候如果实现分布控制而不是直接控制的话，那么它很可能对电网的运行是有一定的影响，就会让它去新投入一些资金去建一些新的设备，而且呢他们本身 utility 有的运行方式它是 recover cost 为主的，它就算是你能够解决自己产生这个问题的话呢，如果它没有办法进行新的投资，它会收不回成本。所以说从 utility 的这个角度讲，我觉得它会就是说技术上实现它本身呢，对它来讲就这个微网最后能够 adapt in 这个 system 来讲，对它实际上是个次要的问题。那么如果要是在 policy 这个基础上它非要运行这个东西的话，那我觉得最大的难点实际上是在那个 protection relay 和它的一个控制上面，因为这中间涉及到一个就是它怎么接入这个现有的这个电力保护这个系统，我觉得这个方面实际上在新的那个运行这些角度来讲并没有真正的运行经验，在今后怎么去调整这个现有的保护和你现在这个微网上来以后对这个系统的冲击，只能是有了运行经验以后才能够做到，对吧？
好的，徐老师和顾老师有什么想分享的吗？
喂，
哎，
可以听到，
可以听到，哎，我这边好像。顾老师
听到了，
对，好像他是不是网络中断了，但是喂，顾老师您可以您那边网络好像中断了，可以听到我们说话吗？哦，顾老师好像掉线了。
好，
那要不然徐老师您分享一下您的看法，我们等顾老师再重新上线。
我完全同意刚才陆老师的这个观点啊，我觉得确实就是说，如果我们集中在或者说强调这个网的这个角度的话，那么比如说我要从有去建设一个微网，或者说是去独立出一个微网，那么可能确实有很多这个不管是标准化上的挑战，还有一些这种经济盈利模式方面的一些挑战。所以我的感觉就是说。可能在现实当中的话，我们可能就是说不一定要过多的强调说这个网，可能不一定说非得要把它定义成一个微网。那么我们可能更多的可以从这个第二的这个角度，就是分布式资源本身的这个角度去看。比如说就您刚提到的这个HB1547，那么它是一个对于这种参与这个电压控制方面的一个标准。那么我印象中，我前段看了这个最新的一个报告，就是说他们现在已经，就是说鼓励我这个 solar inverter 去参与系统的这个调压，或者说至少是提供系统调压的这个支撑。那么以前我的这个 solar PV 肯定就是 unity control 或者 MPPT 嘛，我可能第一是不允许参与调压，第二的话从用户的角度可能他也不乐意这样会把他的这个控制的系统搞得更复杂。但如果说我们有这种更好的这个标准，那么去鼓励这种用户自身的这个 DER 的资源去参与系统的服务，那么可能这个 相对来讲从整个网的角度它可能就会相对来讲比较容易获得接受。比如说我的这个运营商，我姑且可以给，比如说你参与了我的这个调压，那么我可以给你一定的这个激励机制不管是怎么样各种各样的一个激励机制，甚至我可以强制做一些这个 grid code 要求你必须参与系统的这个调压。因为本质上来讲，我配电网中的这个电压的波动很大一部分原因是由于你的这个光伏的出力波动而导致的这个可能是这个方面。那么比如说其他的方面，如果是从储能系统的角度或者是用户自身的这个需求在响应的角度，那么我们如果只把它从这个 resource 的角度去看我觉得可能就会有更大的一个这个空间和接受度。比如说它盈利的模式，那么我们储能系统不且可以参套利的这个模式，或者是提供一些其他的这个辅助服务我们就是说在新加坡的话，最近上个月接连有好几个新的这个 ground call那么他们就是希望这个从叫做啥工业负荷的角度来讲，去安装一些新的这个储能，然后的话更好的这个叫做什么，一方面是去补偿它整个这个time of use， 就是这个分时电价另一方面的话可能能够就是在电压质在电能质量上方面给这个本地的这个就是发工厂做一些支撑。所以我的理解就是可能在现实生活中我们可以更多这个 resource 作为一个个体而不是就是说过多强调这个网。因为确实如果是过多强调这个网，那么从这个大电网的从运营商的角度，他可能不希望你在他的这个地盘里独立出一块东西这个是我。谢谢。
谢谢。顾伟老师刚才好像我们网络出了一点问题，那么
对我刚刚好像说话你们听不到对吧？
对的。
现在能听到吗？
现在可以听得很清楚。
那个前面虽然问题我刚刚网络不好没听到，但是我刚刚大概听了一下这个徐老师跟陆老师的这个发言，我大概知道就是可能是了解一下，就是说我们微网未来的这样一些发展场景，或者说是就是在什么样的一些场景下面会有比较好的这样一个发展啊。那么个人从国内的情况来看的话呢，其实早些年微网这个主要还是因为建设的成本比较高，然后另外的话呢就是这个不赚钱对吧，没有相关的一些这个如果没有政策，因为前期嘛有一些政策配套对不对包括建设包括这个电价上面的这样一些政策，所以说的话呢建了一批但是后期的话呢我想就是说未来肯定是这样子，就是说它需要通过和电就是建设微网的目的的话呢首先的话呢我认为肯定是有需求因地制宜去做，比如说我在一些海岛或者边远的这样一些山区，我的一些独立供电系统需要满足我当地的这样一些供电需求的这种离网型的，这个是很有必要的。那么在城市啊或者新兴城镇里面一些并网型的它这个必要性在哪里的话呢，实际上来讲在大量的这个分布电源接入之后，刚刚大家有讲就是说如果说我考核你电压或者电能质量一些问题，那么你可能都会存在这个超标或者越线等等，会面临着这个比如说这个电力公司的这样一些罚款对吧。那么我可能强制就要求你需要去做一些储能，把你的这个功率来进行评议，然后另外的话呢你建这个微网的主要目的的话呢也是希望你能够实现你这个电力的自给自足对吧。如果说你不自给自足或者说你是纯上网对吧，你这个光伏，那我这个就不是一个微网对吧。这是一种这个需求。另外的话呢我也是在想就是说未来的话呢这个微网的话呢也可以通过给这个电网的话提供一些辅助服务，比如说这个功率调节调频这样一些服务的话呢来获利。现在实际上来讲国内的话呢这一块其实刚刚起来，我知道那个河南嘛刚刚他那个需求响应现在已经可以直接支付费用了，然后另外的话呢就是广东这一块应该也是做的比较好的，现在的话呢就是搞这种符合的这个聚合商对吧，然后我们也可以把微网聚合进去对不对，他马上的话呢也会需求响应也会给相应的这样一些补贴，那么通过这样一些的话呢来获利，这样才有可能就是说在这种城市里面 这样一个微网才有它存在的这样一个必要性，就是有这样一个生存和发展的空间。否则的话呢，就是说如果说你纯靠常规的，那么大家可能会觉得这个除非是一些这个公链可靠性要求比较高的这个地方，我否则我没有必要就是说去建一个微网，这个大概是我个人的一个观点。
好的，谢谢几位老师的这个分享。那么由于时间的关系呢，我们今天的圆桌讨论环节就到这里。然后相信大家还是意犹未尽的，然后包括很多观众也会有很多问题希望跟我们的嘉宾进行讨论，那么我们就进入到下一个环节，就是观众问答和自由讨论环节。那么请樊淼师兄主持。师兄你要那个unmute 一下。
好的，非常感谢姚瑞博士，还有感谢三位教授非常精彩的这个讨论。那咱们现在就进入到最后一个环节，就是观众提问和自由讨论。另外呢，我在这个 Zoom 里面的这个讨论区里面呢，我会就是发一个 survey 一个 link， 然后大家可以去点进去，然后去评价一下我们这个本期的这个 webinar 的一些情况。那我是收集到了有大概有四个问题。那第一个问题呢，就是问这个徐岩教授，但是它是一个概念性的问题。是说what's the difference between decentralized control and distributed control？ 这个徐岩教授能回答一下。
范博士，我刚才看到这个聊天记录里的这个问题了，我实际上刚刚把这个我也在里面那个回复了一下那个打出来的字。简单来讲的话，就是说再讲一遍的话，就是说decentralized control 就是说本地控制，那么我需要这个外界的不需要与外界通信，我只需要本地的测量信号，比如说我的这个 Joule control， 简而言之其实就是 Joule control 了。我测量到电压和频率之后，我就就地的去提供P 和 Q 的这么一个改变，这是decentralized。 那么 distributed control 是讲我们需要和外界通信，但是这个通信和central 的就不一样，它的这个通信是每一个节点只需要和这个就是相邻节点去通信，它不需要集中起来和一个节点去通信，所以这个是对，是分布式控制。然后至于说这个模型是不是需要给这个review 的 to each setting， 这个是不需要的。我们只需要把我们一定的这个，或者说其实就是每一个 agent 的这个状态 state 的这个信息传递给相邻的节点，本身自己的模型是不需要的。谢谢。
好的，那第二个问题呢是西安交通大学的陈晨教授提的，就是说。你的那个Raspberry Pi controller 用的这个通讯的 scheme 是 RealLine 还是一个你们内部的一个 NS3 的这样？
对啊，这个就是说我在我们的这个平台上，我们这个 RPI 的通信是这个这个 LAN 是 LAN 是用这个直接用 LAN 来做的然后的话就是说您第二个问题是提到这个 cloud based 的方法。Time delay 是不是有影响这个是有影响我再把这个就是说我们那个的那个结果在这里就是说再做一个讨论一下现在您可以看到我的这个屏幕吧？
可以
对，就是说这个通信的影响当然是对这种分布式控制非常重要，一方面通信的延迟，另一方面包括这个通信的丢失 communication failure这个是我们做的一个怎么说 impact study， 我们考虑了不同的这个，我们用 NS3 去仿真不同的这个通信的 delay。 简而言之的话，我们整个系统它有一个叫做最大的 delay 的能够允许的时间 tolerance， 我们超过这个 time delay tolerance 之后，系统就变得失稳了。所以的话说就是说我们实际上对于这个系统，我们发现实际上它的这个 time delay tolerance 大概是在 反正大概是在多少几百个毫秒，我有点具体记不清楚了，但一个500一个150，那么应该是来讲500的时候都还没有失稳，它的这个 tolerance 是在500毫秒以上，这个是关于那个 delay 的。 delay 的话我们有很多种办法去克服了，一方面是从这个控制器本身的自己的这个设计来讲，你可以加一个这个叫做这个叫一个什么什么项supplementary 的这个 unit， 这是一种比较复杂的方法。另外一种简单的方法呢，就是我们去可以调一调这个 control gain、基本上来讲的话，我的这个把 control gain 调小一点我就可以允许更大的这个 delay， 但是缺点就是这样的话我的收敛速度就比较慢，收敛速度比较慢。反而言之就是你如果收敛速度快，你把 gain 调大，但是呢 你可以这个允许的 delay 就比较小。然后另外一个除了 delay 的话， communication failure 其实也是很常见，比如说我们这个尤其是这种经过远程的这个通信它的可能通信的可靠性不能够100%保证。那么这个 communication failure 的话，这个具体的影响来讲简而言之从这个图论的角度来说，我丢失一维的communication link， 那么我整个图的连接性就减弱了，所以的话我的收敛速度就降低了。然后如果对于极端的 case， 比如说我的这个 node 已经它的通信已经被隔离出去了，比如说这种情况我的这个节点3它这两个通信都断掉了，那么它等于已经跟这个系统脱离了，所以这样的话它就这个节点3就没办法继续参与这个叫做啥二次控制了，它可能就只能就是说按照它自己局部的这个控制规则去动作，那么其余剩余的节点呢会继续的按照这个 consensus 的这个控制的这个规则去走。所以这个的话这也是这个叫做什么 distributed control 的一个优点，就是它可以支持你这种 plug and play， 比如说我这个节点掉了之后，那我其他的我可以继续做，我可以继续去通信，当然我们的收敛速度performance 会受影响，但是本质上它最终会达到一个收敛状态。然后这个通信线路恢复了之后它又回来了，比如说我们现在又做了一个比如说150秒的时候，这个通信这个3它又回来了，跟2又接上了，那么它又继续参与到系统的这个调频，所以这个就是我们说的叫plug and play， 对，大概就是这么个意思。
好的，那最后一个问题，最后一个问题是说你的这个 slice 第一页里面，你推导那个 eigenvalue analysis， 它是问你就是什么样的增益，什么样的 gain 会 make the system unstable。
我猜您可能讲的其实就是这一页吧，其实就是这一页。
嗯
，eigenvalue 那您是说这个？您是说这个吗？对，只有这个，我印象中应该只有这一页是有这个 eigenvalue。那么这个的话，我们就是画这个叫做根轨迹了特征根的轨迹，然后我们调不同的这个 gain， 那么特征根的轨迹就是长这样。至于说为什么它会失稳因为怎么讲，这个 gain 是整个系统很重要的一个控制参数，那么这个参数如果说没有调好，那系统就是会失稳这个就是怎么讲，就是由于系统本身的一个特性了，因为 control gain 是很重要的一个控制参数。对，这个的话我们就是直接就画出这个根的特征根的轨迹。
好的，我看到有一个新的问题是问顾伟教授的，是在讨论区，是说刚才听到顾伟老师提到现在的微电网发展方向趋于多样化，请问在微电网中考虑不同的储能系统响应等因素的前提下，哪些储能系统具有更高的效率和更好的经济效益，更适合于微电网，哪些的
我看到这个问题了。目前的话呢，就是说国内用到的这个储能的话呢，其实主要是以这个电池储能为主。那么原来的话呢，其实就是说是这种铅酸电池，现在的话呢用的这个铅碳的比较多。用的铅碳比较多。然后锂电池呢这两年就是说这个国内的这个就是这个价格下降的也比较厉害，那么目前的话呢也有个别的去用但是经济性还是稍微差了一点。我所知道的就是说现在用的这个就是这个铅碳电池，然后 有还有一些就是说磷酸铁锂的电池在示范工程里面会去用。其他类型的储能啊，比如说这种什么压缩空气储能啊，还有一些这种这个比如大型的这种抽水蓄能啊等等，它因为它需要一些这个特殊的条件啊，并没有就是说这个广泛的这种应用。
好的，那这应该就是最后一个问题了。那最后呢，就做一下这个讲座的预告，是我们会在6月27号，也就是两周以后的周六，做一个关于这个电脑网的开发与应用的一个讲座，是请到了史迪博士和李方兴教授，参与。并且是由黄灿博士呢主持的这样一个 webinar。 那最后呢，还是感谢几位参与本次 webinar 的教授，感谢徐安教授的精彩报告，也感谢陆宁教授和顾伟教授参与讨论，最后呢，也感谢参与 webinar 的几位工作人员，感谢我们的 NACPPA 的主席张强还有孙凯教授，感谢提供技术支持的刘平、姚一运还有张弛，也感谢负责录像的王斌还有燕磊。最后呢，我们 NACPPA 在之前搞了一个活动，叫做 Power Future Lego Challenge， 就是请一些小朋友用他们的乐高积木搭建一些他们心中未来的电力系统的一些 device。